Exmoor National Park is a special place. Its beautiful and varied landscape is recognised as one of the finest in Britain. There are 250 square miles of wooded valleys, high moors, rolling hills and rugged coast, dotted with farms, villages and wonderful country inns. But the Exmoor you see today is a product of a rich and fascinating history that made it the way it is now. And if you look closely, you'll see evidence of this. Transformations, not just in the last century, but back through Victorian times, the Middle Ages, through hundreds and thousands of years to the first appearance of man, and ultimately to the very formation of the continents 200 million years ago. Our story starts with a single vast continent called Pangaea. While dinosaurs still roamed the land, earth-shattering forces gradually broke up this landmass, and the movement of the huge tectonic plates of the Earth's crust opened up oceans, lifted up mountain ranges, and started to create the continental shapes we know today. If you take a walk on the beach at Coombe Martin, you can still see evidence of these upheavals. These lines in the rocks are layers of ancient bedrock formed around 400 million years ago from sediments in a shallow sea that was actually near the equator. But here they are today, thousands of miles north, split, broken, and thrown up at all angles, torn apart by those huge forces millions of years ago. A gentler effect was the crumpling of the land. Again, movement of the different sections of the Earth's crust was the cause. These ripples in the land, running roughly northwest to southeast, can be seen all over this part of England. Over time, water flowing off the higher land made a significant impact on the terrain, eroding down further the valleys in the crumpled landscape and creating new valleys of its own. These are evident in the many coombs which are characteristic of Exmoor and have given their names to towns and villages all over the region. And over those millions of years, life was evolving. But all this was during the last ice age, and the world would have looked very different. Exmoor was a cold land that belonged to species such as woolly mammoths, saber-toothed tigers, and ancient horses. The hardy but beautiful Exmoor ponies that you see today would have looked very much like them. The earliest evidence of man in Britain dates back 100,000 years, and small numbers of our ancestors would have been here on Exmoor in the occasional warmer phases that man would venture this far north. With so much water locked up in the ice caps, the sea level would have been very much lower. Stone Age man would have been able to hunt across the Bristol Channel, which would have been mainly dry land, and you could have walked to Lundy Island. Over many thousands of years, the Ice Age would begin to lose its grip, and trees would have started to grow over much of Exmoor. By the end of the Ice Age, there had been a huge rise in sea levels, flooding the channel and sending the animals and our ancestors up onto higher ground. This is Porlock Bay, as it is today, nestled on the coast. Here at low tide, the mysterious stumps of alder and oak emerge like ghosts of an ancient past, clear evidence of forests that once covered what is now the seabed. Pieces of flint have been found around Exmoor, including down among the rocks in Porlock Bay. But flint isn't found naturally here, so it's likely that these early inhabitants were highly mobile, roaming over wide distances and perhaps carrying toolkits with them to make new tools in their seasonal encampments. And at Porlock Visitor Centre, you'll find this fine beast, an auroch, an ancient breed of cattle that would have roamed the land at this time. In 1996, after storms exposed older layers of silt below the coastal marshes at Porlock, its bones were also revealed. No doubt many more lie beneath what's now the sea floor. Our hunter ancestors would have had a wide diet. Nuts, plants, berries and seafood, but animal meat such as the auroch would have also been an important food source, and the skins and fat from the animals valuable to winter survival. The ancient people were already making their mark on the landscape, clearing spaces within the woodland where animals could graze. They also made their mark on the land in stone. There are many stone rows, stone circles and stone settings all over Exmoor, which are thought to date from the end of the Neolithic period, around 4,000 years ago. You'll see many of them marked on the Explorer map. Some are easy to visit, others you'll need to look quite hard to find. The largest and most striking is the Longstone. At 9 foot high, this single stone dominates the landscape. It's a walk to get to it, but worth the effort. The stones may have been monuments, places of ritual, perhaps simply boundary markers. We do know these stones were put there by our ancestors, but to this day, we still don't know exactly why. The construction of the earliest earthwork sites also began during this time in the form of barrows and cairns used for human burial. These occur nearly everywhere on Exmoor. There are almost 400 of them. You can walk among them and imagine what you might have seen around you 4,000 years ago. Across Exmoor today, you'll see field systems, hedgerows and boundaries. And while most of what you see was developed later, it was the original hunter-gatherers who first began to form small settlements and manage the land around them, clearing forest to provide room for cultivation and animal herds. Fragments of ancient fields have been found, as well as traces of roundhouses dating back from 3,000 years ago, the Bronze Age. This was, for Britain, the dawn of civilization. In around 750 BC, ironworking techniques reached Britain. Stronger and more plentiful than bronze, its introduction would revolutionize many aspects of life, most importantly, agriculture. There is evidence on Exmoor of iron workings dating back to this time. Our ancestors would have been able to identify seams of iron by the color changes in the rocks and the vegetation. You can also see evidence of defended settlements from the Iron Age, situated on slopes and hilltops. This is what Bat's Castle might have looked like. It's just south of Dunster. And this is Berry Castle, north of Selworthy. The type and location of their construction suggests small-scale societies that were in contact and in conflict with their neighbours. But none of these early British societies have any known surviving language or literature. All this history, culture, and way of life are projected mainly through archaeological finds. So even though they would have had trade links with cultures from other parts of Europe, when a society arrived in Britain whose art, technology and language totally surpassed anything our ancestors on Exmoor had ever experienced, it must have been like meeting beings from outer space. The Romans arrived in Britain in AD 43, and in the following years set up a major fortress in Exeter supported by a network of smaller forts and garrisons, such as this extremely well-preserved fortlet at Oldborough. The fortlet overlooks the sea and the south coast of Wales, which was unconquered at the time. So it was likely established to watch from the edge of the empire and was probably in communication with the Roman fleet at sea. You can visit this outpost today and still clearly see the outer ridge, which would have been for defences, and a smaller rectangular inner, which would have been an enclosed area. Excavations here have revealed posts, which suggests this was a tented camp, used only for a few years. The cultural changes that the Romans brought with them, from the wearing of hobnailed shoes to improved pottery, are apparent on sites such as this, which have been explored. But the most striking discovery on Exmoor was the amount of iron being produced. Excavations near Simmons Bath have revealed that during the Roman occupation, iron production reached an enormous scale, far greater than to supply local needs. Here at Berkham was a well-known source of iron ore. While it was exploited well into the 19th century, creating this massive openwork, mining here is believed to date back to the Romans and before. The question remains whether the Roman army were overseeing and directing these operations, or whether a local entrepreneur seized the opportunity to supply iron to markets throughout the Roman Empire. The Romans more or less left Britain to govern itself as their focus turned to threats elsewhere. But an interesting reminder of Roman rule on Exmoor is here on Winsford Hill. This stone, actually erected long after the Romans left, bears the inscription "Grandson of Caraticus" and was probably put here by a local notable declaring his descent from the legendary and possibly part mythical Caraticus, not a Roman, but a very British hero. The irony is that such a stone inscription is a very Roman trait, and it's only as a legacy of Roman intervention that people on Exmoor were able to read and write. Then, enter the Saxons, who left their name in the towns and villages of Exmoor. The Tun of Dulverton and place names ending in Cot, Ham and Worthy are all Anglo-Saxon words related to hamlets or farms. We don't truly know a lot about the early medieval period, one reason it's known a little misleadingly as the Dark Ages. But it's likely that during this time, some of the farms and villages that you can see today were already established across Exmoor. Certainly there were churches, or places of worship, probably built in timber. The pretty church you see today at Selworthy may not date back that far, but the name of the village certainly does. And if you visit the church at Porlock, itself dating back to the 13th century, you can see remnants of an ancient stone cross, which in Anglo-Saxon times would have stood outside. We do know that a substantial part of Exmoor was designated as royal forest for the Anglo-Saxon kings. The animals would serve as a source of food and clothing for the royal household. And that would have meant a great deal to the local people. It would have meant jobs and money. Then, in 1066, came the Norman Conquest, which would result in yet another cultural shift and significant changes to Exmoor. Not only a change of monarch, but new landowners and a new and rather harsh system of forest law and administration. If you visit the church in the village of Paracombe, you'll be treated to a view across the valley of what is one of the best preserved early Norman castle sites anywhere in the UK. Even today, you can clearly see the shape of its motte and bailey construction. Nearly 1,000 years ago, This would have represented a central raised timber keep, the motte, and a surrounding fortified area known as the bailey for additional storage and living areas. Protected by a surrounding ditch or moat, such a fortification would have been relatively easy to build, probably with forced local labour, and equally formidable as a military stronghold. But perhaps the most significant contribution of the new Norman rulers was something totally different and very much smaller that would change forever our understanding and knowledge of our own history. The Great Survey, by order of King William the Conqueror, was completed in 1086 and recorded in the Domesday Book, a remarkable document that gives us huge detail of the whole country, including Exmoor, at that time. The priority was to ensure the right taxes were being collected on people, buildings, and livestock. Dulverton is recorded as already being quite a large town, having 25 villages, 6 smallholders, and 6 slaves. Dunster, a little smaller, with just 15 households. Exford, just 5 villages and 5 sheep. And another village called Badgery, recorded as small with 2 households, but with 24 sheep, other animals, and 30 acres of pasture, so already a busy farm. Today, Dunster is a bustling town, but retains one of Britain's best examples of medieval town layout. The castle, originally a Norman fort built out of wood but later rebuilt in stone, dominates a main street that still today retains the shape of the original borough town. Behind the Luttrell Arms, itself dating back to the late 1400s, works have revealed the layout of lost buildings. Excavation here in 2016 revealed long, thin plots. The plots either side of the high street would have been this way. The expensive street frontage would have been narrow, and many of them shop fronts with the living areas behind. The excavation also revealed a later circular structure, maybe an oven for baking or a kiln for drying barley for brewing. Perhaps the shop front could have been a small alehouse even then. The Royal Forest took on increasing importance for hunting and for grazing animals on the royal land, said to number 43,000 by the early 1600s. The wool trade became a key contributor to local income, and in Dunster you can still see the wonderfully preserved yarn market, built in 1609, where farmers and buyers would haggle for the best product at the best price. Forest law was administrated by a special parliament, and there were inspections of the forest boundaries known as perambulations. These are continued to this day, although they serve no real purpose. It's a link to the past for locals and visitors. It's interesting to see how the pattern of farms and villages recorded almost 1,000 years ago so closely resembles that of today, with some notable exceptions. Cross the bridge at Malmesmead and you'll find signs to Badgery Valley. Badgery, just as Exford and Dunster, was recorded in the Domesday Book as a growing village. But here is Badgery today. On the one hand, it's a fascinating place to explore traces of field enclosures and dwellings as they would have stood some 700 years ago. On the other, it poses the question, why, when other towns flourished and grew, was this one abandoned? Perhaps some local plague or other catastrophe led to its decline. Or perhaps it was simply that better wages could be found elsewhere. Something you can ponder on yourself as you walk back down the valley, which rather later would earn itself a completely different name. Throughout the ages, life on Exmoor for many was a struggle against the elements. From the early hunters to the farmers of the Middle Ages, Exmoor mattered largely only to the people that lived and worked here. Then, in the 1700s, As an appreciation of art and literature gathered pace, the great poets and painters of the day started to take an interest too. Suddenly, landscapes were to be gazed upon as well as farmed, and the great outdoors marveled at and written about. Percy Bysshe Shelley, Samuel Taylor Coleridge, and William Wordsworth all spent time here on Exmoor. It was here that Coleridge found the inspiration to write the Rime of the Ancient Mariner, and Wordsworth described Valley of Rocks as a beautiful work of nature's art. But most of all, Coleridge and his friend Wordsworth would walk and enjoy the sights and sounds of Exmoor, particularly around Porlock and Culburn Woods. And today, with the Coleridge Way recently extended by a 15-mile inland route from Porlock to Lynmouth, you too can follow in the footsteps of the Romantic poets. By the early 1800s, the concept of royal forests had largely disappeared, although Exmoor still remained. Enter John Knight, a wealthy man from Worcestershire, already an accomplished agriculturalist, who went about buying practically all of the old royal forest and set in progress development that would have huge effect. His plan was to turn Exmoor into a single estate, one thing he never actually achieved. What he did do, however, was turn significant amounts of wilderness into more productive land. He had banks and hedges constructed, hundreds of miles of them built by hand, which stand to this day. He built, or started to build, a boundary around the huge estate area. He commissioned a mansion to be built in Simmonsbath, the centre of his lands, and his vision was to control the whole estate from there. He created a reservoir, Pinkery Pond, to generate his water supply and provide water power. He had a sawmill built at Simmonsbath too. This water-driven facility was designed to supply cut wood for his whole estate, and is maintained and occasionally run by enthusiasts to this day. Then, in 1837, just 17 years after he moved here, John Knight and most of his family left. No one is exactly sure why, but his line and his vision was continued and developed by one of his sons, Frederick. The plans included developing Porlock Weir as a port. It never happened, but the railway built to serve it was started. But in the end, the grand plan simply couldn't be sustained. Even the great mansion, the centre of the estate at Simmonsbath, was never completed. What remains now forms part of the hotel and an outdoor education centre. But even though John Knight never succeeded in his grand plan, what was astonishing was the vision and impact this one man, albeit with the help of staff and several hundred labourers, could make. And the landscape of Exmoor will bear the mark of John Knight and his family far into our future. Although Exmoor was now on the Victorian tourist map, not for the first time, a book changed everything. Built on local folklore and loosely based on a real set of characters, the novel Lorna Doone, written by Richard Doddridge Blackmore in 1869, captured the imagination of the nation. The East Lynne Valley became Doone Valley. Orr Church and other locations featured in the book, and Badgery changed from being a deserted and neglected ruin to a cherished site that everyone wanted to visit. Since 1870, the book has never been out of print. And still today, the area is known as Doom Country, and the valley remains a hugely popular place to visit and explore. Through the 1900s, transport links improved and local towns became more well-equipped, attracting more citizens to live all year round and tourists in the less challenging months. Linton, Lynmouth, Porlock, and other towns provided diversions and a touch of comfort for the Victorian visitors. But really, since the Knights' improvements in the 1800s, it's been a gradual process of slow modernisation to this very day. Apart from one significant episode, when Exmoor was touched, like pretty much everywhere else, by two world wars. In fact, Exmoor largely escaped the attention of Hitler, but not of Britain and its allies. Large parts of Exmoor became a training ground, particularly for tank regiments. And up on North Hill, you'll still find hard standings where the armed vehicles were parked and inspected. These woods were filled with accommodation huts for personnel, although only some rather curious stone steps remain. You can also see one of the first ever radar stations, groundbreaking technology at the time, positioned to keep watch for enemy vessels or low-flying aircraft that might try and make their way up the Bristol Channel. On an aerial photograph, you can see the tracks the tanks followed. They would roll around these triangular courses, firing at targets pulled on small railways across the valley. Those triangular courses are still visible in aerial photographs today. Some of Exmoor's most ancient and precious history was spared, marked as sites of special interest and not to be fired on. But the farms of Exmoor didn't escape completely. Some were requisitioned for target practice. Even the very last cottage ever built on the site of medieval badgery turned to rubble. And that is how you'll find it today. Exmoor is a unique and diverse landscape of moorland, woodland, coastline, characterful towns, and much more. It's rich in history, wildlife, and the occasional surprise. And as you explore everything that Exmoor has to offer, it might be even more rewarding to scratch the surface just a little deeper and understand how what you see today has actually been shaped by nature and by people over many thousands of years.